Instructional Designers in Offices Drinking Coffee is brought to you by dominKnow, makers of dominKnow One, the all-in-one cloud-based e-learning authoring tool for teams. You can learn more at dominKnow.com. That's dominKnow.com. Now, here's this week's episode. Good morning, folks. How's everybody doing today?
Doing just fine. This is the secret ghost voice in the background today.
It's the disembodied voice of Brent. Brent, can you rattle those chains a little more for us to
dang it.
Do a little whole Marley thing coming on Christmas season soon?
I forgot the chains.
No kidding. Folks, Brent is not able to join us visually today because Brent is currently in between locations. So he's joining us.
Secret undisclosed bunker.
In fact, we had to put him under lock and key. He's so precious. We had to tuck him away. No, Brent's going to join us by audio only because he's having some internet challenges today. Like, we don't always have internet challenges in this on Wednesday mornings when we do this thing, right? But finally, it's Brent's turn and not mine. So anyway, good morning to everybody in the chat. I'm just going to kill the music here. Let's do that. There we go. Hey, gang. A little bit of weather forecasting maybe in the chat. Here in Eastern Ontario, it is a gray kind of fall day. It's a little rain, that kind of thing. But man, the leaves in our neighborhood are just starting to pop. Real nice. This is the nicest part of fall. And in 2 weeks, the trees will be naked and empty and everything will feel dreary and then we'll all get sad. But anyway, folks, we have an awesome guest with us here today. Liza Wisner is joining us here. Liza, where are you joining us from geographically? I forgot to check in on that.
Yes, I am in Corpus Christi, Texas.
Awesome. So yes. It's the first time you've joined us here. Give us a little introduction to yourself for the folks that are in our chat here today.
Sure, thanks. So I like to call myself a talent development expert. I am professionally trained in computer science and then later decided how much I loved educating people about technology. So I got my master's in ed tech. And from there, I have to say is I absolutely love sharing knowledge and the implementation of knowledge into systems and operations of businesses. So I love people and I love technology and I figure out how to put them together. And
very
the
excellent.
Magic happens.
Very awesome. And we were talking a little bit in the green room that you've had an experience that many of us don't get to put on our resumes or our biographies. You were actually a guest on a certain show.
Yes.
Want to give us a little insight into that? Tell us a bit about that.
Oh my gosh. That was a long time ago, by the way. So I would say that was another, I would say maybe people live multiple lives. That was another life that I had. So I was on the television show, The Apprentice on NBC. And it was a great experience. In fact, the company I started when I was working on my master's degree is what led me to be on The Apprentice. And totally unexpected, you know, when you start a business when you're in college, you're just doing it because you got to write papers and you're just thinking, why am I doing this? Let me figure out something that's going to make me feel like doing this. And yeah, next thing you know, I have a business and it's doing well and I'm on The Apprentice. So it was great.
That's a really unusual path that when you're doing graduate studies that somehow it gets you onto television. It doesn't work that way for most people, does it? No way. Yeah. No way. So.
Yeah, but not only were you on The Apprentice, you were actually a finalist. So you did very well on The Apprentice, I should add.
Thanks. Brent, you know, and I, you know, one of the things that I think you could say I was the most unlikely candidate to be on the show, first of all, okay? Liza Wisner from Corpus Christi. Does anyone know where that is? And from Kenya, starting a technology company, you know, like what's going on? And then being on the show was kind of difficult for me. I feel like I grew my, I guess it was like a, I tell people that it was like my MBA boot camp, right? I really learned a lot during that show. But yes, I made it to the top three, to be a top three finalist. And it really surprised me, but it reiterated to me how much we underestimate our value because we don't realize, you know, I was thinking, oh my gosh, you know, these people have been making $1 million deals, you know, and they have huge companies and they're going to do really, really well. And oh my gosh, I'm so intimidated, not realizing that they have nothing on you if you know your true value. And so I think that's literally what I wrote on was, you don't know who I am and what I'm fighting for. So get out of my way. I'm about to win this thing.
Brilliant. Yeah. Brilliant. So we have an official topic that we're gathered together here today to talk about was diversity, equity, and inclusion, and particularly how, I guess, training departments can support that. We think of maybe sometimes these are things that happen more in the HR, you know, section of things, and when you're thinking about from an organizational perspective, but sort of zeroing in maybe today a little bit on training departments and L&D departments. Let's maybe just start with the basics. We've had a couple of sessions around these topics, but everybody's got a little bit of a different take on what those words, diversity, you know, equity and inclusion mean, sometimes coming from slightly, you know, different angles, et cetera. So maybe we'll start there with, you know, what those words mean for you. And then particularly in the sense of organizational development.
For sure. And if you don't mind, I know we talked about this earlier, but I actually have a little short deck that I can share to give some context around the conversation. Is that okay?
Yeah, totally.
So I'll go ahead and share my screen. And, you know, the reason why I always have slides when I talk about DEI is because I am a visual person. So if you're watching right now and you're a visual person, I see Cassie went to high school in San Antonio. Hello, Cassie. In the chat, just put, yes, you're a visual person, because then this presentation is for you. So DEI is essentially the abbreviation for diversity, equity, and inclusion. And, you know, for me, when I think about diversity, equity, and inclusion, I think about it in terms of all the ways that we are different, right? So essentially when you know, the world refers to DEI in the business world, it's about the inclusion of individuals with many different identities and backgrounds. And as you can see here on this slide, it just kind of shows you all the different ways that we're different. Can you see that, Chris and Brent?
Yep.
Like
yep.
All the different ways, right? So whether we're talking about your age, your ability, you know, your relational, your occupational, right? And we're even talking about the context as it relates to your mindset and your skills, right? But the simplest form of defining what diversity means in the context of DEI is this slide, which actually talks about how DEI can be broken up into two parts. So as you can see here, we have inherent diversity, which are typically your physical traits. So for example, when we talked about age, appearance, gender, you know, these are who you are or what others think they see when they see you. Okay. And then the other side of diversity is your acquired traits. So these are the things that you gain from your lived experience. So the languages we speak, right? We're speaking a common language here, English, right? Mm-hmm. And some people speak other languages that they picked up through their upbringing. Your skills, your talents, your strengths, you know, your work style, your education level, your communication style, even your cognitive diversity, you know, all the approaches that you take to problem solving and thinking. And again, we can go on and on talking about diversity. It's not just as simple as when people talk about race and gender. There are dimensions of diversity. And so typically the primary and the on this slide, you can see like you have your personality, you have your primary layers. Those are typically your inherent traits. Those are who you are or what people think they see when they see you. And the rest of diversity is acquired. And that's the part that excites me, right? Because I think that's the part that organizations can capitalize on. And essentially diversity is just the simple acknowledgement of difference. Now, when I think of diversity, I also wanted to bring in this slide that talks about intersectionality. Now, Chris and Brent, have you ever heard of this term, intersectionality?
Yeah, we've looked at it a couple of different sessions.
Yeah,
it's come up a few times for sure. Yeah.
So as you can see from this slide, it's essentially just the interconnected nature of diversity and the categorizations that we create for people, right? So you saw all those categorizations. Intersectionality really just means that we need to account for the full human, right? Not just are they, you know, like, okay, so like me, for example, I'm a Black woman, right? Who's a mom, an immigrant to the US, right? But you have to see all of that. You don't just see me in my individual, you know, makeups of my identity, right? Now, Kimberly Crenshaw actually has a TED Talk that talks about the power of intersectionality. So if you like TED Talks, go and watch that TED Talk. But the reason I bring this up is because I think that when we talk about diversity, it's important to make sure that you understand that each aspect of diversity informs the other. And so when I see the definition of intersectionality, I see my identities sort of overlapping, right? So when you talk about intersectionality, you remind people that, you know, you can't say that you know a person because they're a certain race or a gender and you know somebody like that. Like, everyone has a different lived experience. Does that make sense?
Oh, totally. Yeah, totally.
And then the E in equity. The E in equity is sometimes confused with the word equality. And I absolutely love this graphic by the Robert Woods Johnson Foundation. And it really illustrates how, like, if you imagine there's four people going on a bike ride and they all needed a bike. If it was equality, if it was all equal, we would give them all the same bike. And Brett and Chris, can you see how not everyone's going to get there? Well, for sure. Right? Some people may not even get started. Right. And so the reason I like this slide is because the next part talks about equity. And hopefully in the chat, you can see, you can chime in and say, yes, you can see why equity is important versus equality. We want equity because we want everybody to have fair access to the resources. When you say you want it to be equal, then what you're saying is you want everyone to have the same, but one size does not fit all. We have to provide equity so that we all reach the destination successfully. And then inclusion for me is all about a behavior, right? So when I see inclusion, I think about how can we bring diversity, right? Diversity is the fact, and then behavior is the action of bringing everyone together. And so on this last slide, I always want to bring in this really great quote by Verne Myers, who is, by the way, the chief diversity officer, vice president of diversity at Netflix. She's pretty amazing. And she coined the phrase, you know, diversity is being invited to the party and inclusion is being asked to dance. And so when we extend this quote, we want to make sure that equity is being invited to the planning committee. You know how you played the music in the beginning, Brett and Chris? Mm-hmm. You all know that song. And I noticed you, Chris, you were like snapping along, right? So this was y'all's party, right? So you were part of the planning committee, right? Equity means that everyone who's going to be coming to the party gets to say what's on the playlist, you know? So that way they're all dancing to the music and they feel like they belong when they get to the party. Does that make sense?
For sure.
Oh, yeah. I like to think everybody in our chat feels like they belong to the idiotic party that we throw every Wednesday morning.
I would hope so too. You know, I feel like you have a great audience. Some great audience with great emojis, some smiling emojis. So I think they're happy.
Yeah, we have some of the best folks that join us every week in the chat for sure. So you know, working from that set of that sort of groundwork, that kind of structure, then how do we start doing these things or putting these things then, you know, into action when we think about, I don't know, maybe we have to make a new training program or we're thinking about, you know, other things that the training team has to take care of. Where do we start looking at, I guess, putting these things into action?
Yes. And, you know, quite frankly, the point here is that diversity, equity, and inclusion is about optimizing your organization's success, right? So if you understand that, you know, the diversity of thought and the diversity of everyone's experiences brings value to your organization, I sometimes like to say organizations sometimes look for a cultural fit when really what they need to be looking for is a cultural addition, right? You want something different. You want a different perspective. And the way you implement DE&I as part of your training program is by understanding that, first of all, not only do you need to have diversity of learning, right? Because everybody has a different way that they understand information, but you also have to have embedded in there some psychological safety. You know, I think from my personal experience, people learn better when they're in a social environment where they're allowed to make mistakes. And if your team members don't feel safe to make mistakes, they're never going to learn as quickly as you want them to learn. If you want to innovate faster, you have to create a safe environment. And that's how DE&I comes into play in your organization. That's the power of implementing a more inclusive environment in your organization.
Yeah, for sure. And that sense of safety, I mean, it runs through, you know, everything we do as a training department. We have to set up that safe place for people to, because some of the learning that people have to go through, depending on you know, your role, your job, etc., there's a lot going on. And the extra pressure of not feeling safe as you're doing that or taking on that learning or you know, taking in that information, it runs through everything, whether that's, you know, you're learning a new software task. Well, not having to actually know it exactly the first time, but having time to learn it and prepare it. So make a few mistakes, without those mistakes, say having risks, all the way through to, succession type stuff and soft skills, those kinds of things. We really need to make sure that we're creating, whether that's in a classroom or in something that's, you know, asynchronous online, et cetera, a place where people can feel like the learning is what they need to do, not the immediate performance in a sense. That's going to come, but it's, you've got to be able to get there. And
you have to want to. Right. Yeah. And I think when you brought up social soft skills, you know, I follow Simon Sinek. And one of the things that he recently, you know, just spoke a little bit about was how when we talk about soft skills, that there's nothing soft about them. Right. So we think about the hard skills people need to learn, which are their job skills. And soft skills really should be rethought of as human skills, because as humans, we are naturally social creatures. And if you see those so-called soft skills as human skills, you'll really understand that, you know, in today's world, we are all going to encounter people from, you know, all different aspects of our lives, right? So in this society, being a productive member of any organization, and I always sometimes think, okay, when we think of companies, we think of companies, but even in your own family, right? First, you have to feel safe. You have to feel like you relate to people before you're comfortable enough to step out and learn something new and get that information, right? So so let's rename soft skills to human skills. Let's put the human first.
Very true. And there's also something slightly pejorative about the term soft too, right? It's less serious maybe, or certainly can have that kind of, I don't know, an aura around it. Just that term alone makes it feel secondary when really working with other people, whether you're colleagues horizontally or in a management kind of a role.
That's
about how things get done ultimately. So,
yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Cassie's throwing in a note in the chat there. Not soft and hard. So happy to get rid of that idea that some are soft while others are hard. She's rephrasing it as people skills. So, yeah.
I love that.
For sure. Yeah. So we can think about these, making sure that we're creating that, you know, that safe place as part of that learning process, that learning path that we're putting people on. Actually, what I really enjoyed about the bicycle diagram that you had, for example, was it really does emphasize the destination rather than the specifics of the how that someone gets there. And that was a really neat idea to be able to reflect it in that kind of a visual fashion. Pulling us back, I guess, back then, so we create a safe space. What are some of the key things then around that safe space that we need to think about?
Yes. So when we think about psychological safety, one of the teams that I follow a lot of different people. And so one of the books that I really like is a book by Leader Factor. And the book is by an author called Timothy Clark. And Timothy Clark talks about psychological safety in the concept of, you know, there's different stages of psychological safety, but we have to all, first of all, feel included. And that's the first step that everyone kind of lands at and they stay there. But psychological safety is more than just feeling included. Once you have that inclusion safety, then you can have learner safety. Now, learner safety means that your team members are feeling safe, they're comfortable with each other so they can learn, right? And then you eventually move very fast into challenger safety, which is where everybody wants to go. But let me ask you, when we think about organizations capitalizing on everyone's strengths, they always talk about how they want everyone to innovate. They want people to share great ideas, right? But it's like you're skipping all that, right? You're skipping the whole middle, right? So when you want people to flourish, it's really important to make sure, first of all, you create that safe space. But I want you to think about DEI almost like your street lamps, right? So when you create your DE&I programs, you want to see the DE&I values that you've created as the roadmap of the decisions you're making in your organization. And sometimes you'll get on the path and you'll get lost, but see DE&I as those street lamps that always tell you, okay, go with the street lamps, right? Don't go into the darkness, right? So if you say trust is one of your values, if you say transparency is one of your values, when you're making decisions in your organization and you're not providing transparency of information and you're not providing trust within the teams or accountability or whatever your values are, you go back and that's your North Star. That's the decision that you make based off of DE&I. And you know, just to take that even a step further, because again, today we are talking specifically about the learning environment, right? I have to mention that, you know, when we think about learning, we have to see the whole hybrid approach of learning, right? We can't just see it as, okay, we're going to have everybody take this e-learning course on unconscious bias, right? And all our dreams will come true because everybody's now going to know how not to be biased, right? It doesn't work like that. If you are trying to implement DE&I into your learning culture, you really have to understand all aspects of the flow of work, right? And I'm pretty sure you may have talked about the flow of work on your show before, right? Learning in the flow of work.
Yep, it comes up a fair bit for sure.
Yeah. And that's really where the power of DE&I is, because you have to make sure that learning is not seen as this thing you go to do, right? Learning should be just ingrained as part of the organization. It's the reason the organization exists, but it's also the reason why the organization will be successful, because you have a high level of learning in your organization. One of the examples that I can give is just to make sure that information is at the fingertips of your teams, right? So having people take 1 hour courses about, let's say, you know, customer service, let's say, right? So if you're running a call center and it's like this 1 hour training and all the learning that they need, maybe they all need only need that 5 minute reminder, but they have to watch the full training in order to go back to that 5 minute reminder that's going to give them the bit of information. That's not going to be helpful, right? Mm-hmm. So I think as you're thinking about this as a learning professional, think about all the behaviors that you want to implement within the organization and how this information can be at your fingertips. We like to joke that YouTube is almost like the largest learning platform in the world, right? People like to watch videos on YouTube, but when you're trying to do anything in your home or anywhere, what do? The first thing you do is you YouTube it, right? How do I fix such and such? You YouTube it. Why? Because it's one click and one search and you're right there. But yep. Some of our learning management systems, some of our processes for learning within organizations, you have to have your login to the LMS, which is on single sign-on, which is maybe a different login. And then once you're in, now you need access to launch.
Yep,
there's
totally.
Just so many barriers to learning. So so that's what I would say is the information access is important.
And that, I mean, that parallels, you know, a lot of the things that are part of Conrad Gottfredson and Bob Mosher's five moments of learning need, that there are times when formal learning is appropriate, when you're going to learn something new or someone has low experience in something and therefore you want to make sure that they know what they're doing before you put them into the role of doing something. Yes. And then there's also times when people need to learn, you know, something more, or they need to learn something differently because something has changed. That's three of the five and I'm pulling a blank on the other. But what their structure suggests is that, you know, there's a place for formal learning, but there's also a really critical place for providing learning in the flow of work so that people don't have to leave because three of their five ideas are really more something around performance support while you're doing something rather than taking people out of something, taking that 1 hour course and then coming back.
Yes.
And it also ties in with some of the things that we've talked about with repetition, spaced repetition, you know, in particular, that you can have learning at the beginning, but making sure that you're giving people either, you know, refreshers or nudges as you go along. So,
yes.
lots of tie-ins with a lot of the, you know, strong practices that we hope people are actually taking advantage of in the L&D world.
I'm glad you brought that up. I can't remember where I heard this, but I see now I see learning as watering brains. So just to explain that a little further, imagine you have your garden. Again, I'm a super visual person. So everything I'm seeing is like, is there an explanation for this where I can visually see it? Imagine you have your garden and like January 1st, you tell your garden, okay, you're going to get your water for the year, right? Which is sometimes what we do. We say, okay, here's your annual DEI training. Would you flood your garden with all the water that your garden needs for the whole year? What would happen to your garden the next day? Right? Dead. Everything's dead. All the flowers are dead. The grass would probably even drown, right? So you have to see DE&I learning, and I guess just all learning in general, as if you're watering people's brains. You don't flood it, right? You sprinkle in every day. You go out there and intentionally, with focus, being present in the flow of work of where are you watering the gardens? Where are you watering the brains? Water the brains.
So the LMS should be like a sprinkler system.
Yes, yes. And kind of like just, you know, at what, 9 o'clock in the morning, it just for a little bit, right? We're all learning heroes at a certain time of day, right? Together for 15 minutes or whatever. So,
and it's about sustaining then, you know, making sure that the garden is healthy. All four seasons as needed, as opposed to, the analogy even of just putting too much water can actually, you know, drown things too. or wash things out too. So
And you know, and you can put rewards there, right? Because what we when we water our gardens with the sprinkler system, LMS, the sprinkler system of learning, I love that. we get rewarded with green grass, right? And we get rewarded with flowers, right? So when you're creating these sprinkler systems, gamify it, right? Where it's almost like when you turn into a learning hero every day, you commit yourself to these 15-minute modules or whatever that your team members decide to do as far as learning goals every day, reward your team members for it, right? And it could be as simple as, like, for me, you just need to give me a badge somewhere. I just need to see that I did that and I have like a streak, right? And I don't want to break my streak, you know? And so somehow or another, create some learning and some gamification around the environment, and it makes it more fun to want to do the learning.
Yeah, for sure. There's a lot of gamification, of course, obviously uses or offers a lot of little tweaks, etc., for motivation, but usually still playing on the intrinsic motivation that people have, like you were just expressing, a certain competitive sense of, I want the badge, I want the streak, you know, that kind of it's interesting just to think about that, though, and being able to do that, though, again, back in a safe place, so where people aren't feeling like that competitiveness is actually, you know, getting in the way, for instance, of other people, or it's self-competitiveness, I guess, in that perspective, rather than a leaderboard where somebody, I took the most DEI training, you know.
Yeah. And, you know, okay, so here's the thing, right? We are all humans that are different, right? With 7 billion people that are different. Everyone has a different way of being motivated, right? So in some aspects, people are motivated by pay. Others are motivated by recognition. Some people, you recognize them in public and you've lost them. They probably will never want to do something because they don't want to stand up in front of everybody and feel embarrassed, right? And so you just have to find out, how do your team members want to be motivated? And that's why it's important to create all the different ways for the motivation to happen. So me, I want to see my badges. Like, what's the point? What's the point of this thing? I want to see my streak, right? Other people, maybe at the end of it, they just want a certificate and that's it. They don't even want anyone to know that they were doing this, right? So create this space where everybody has a different way that they can see that this learning is happening. And you know, the best way to measure learning is by is measuring the behavior change you're looking for. So a lot of times organizations, when they're measuring the impact of DE&I, they're measuring the demographics of their organization. They're measuring diversity, right? So they're measuring representation, you know, retention, you know, who is here. But you forget about the inclusion measurements, right? And the inclusion measurements are really whether your team members are learning to work together. Are you building psychological safe environments with your teams? And if you are, you're going to see it in those inclusion surveys of, do people feel like they have a voice? Do people feel like they're part of the team? Do they feel like the work they're doing has impact, not only for themselves, but for the community that they serve, right? So that whole measurement is important. Aside from just the numbers of representation, it's important to have inclusion measurements as well.
Yeah, for sure.
How do we...
Go ahead, Brent.
Oh, sorry. Oh, I was just going to ask if there's any... like whenever we're talking about e-learning or design and development and stuff like that, I always like to ask, you know, where has it not worked, right? Or where did something go wrong? Because we have a tendency, we talk about all the good stuff and what we can all learn from that. But I think we can learn a lot from where things didn't go right. Have you heard of any implementations like this that just like struggled, or what were the roadblocks that had to be overcome in order to do that? Because my guess is a lot of executives want to know, oh my gosh, how long is this going to take? Because that's why they always ask us, can you do this in just 1 hour? Can you take this whole, you know, 8 weeks of training and squeeze it down to a 1 hour e-learning? That would be fabulous.
Yeah, that would be great. That would make all your dreams come true, plus world peace, right? No, it's not possible to just do it in an hour, but it's possible to implement it in such a way where it doesn't feel like learning, right? So the very first thing I can say is there are tons of examples of how not to do DE&I in terms of learning and development. One of the examples I can give you, I'm not going to mention the company's name, but they picked a book that was about you know, racial equity, right? And it was a very polarizing book that I would consider a very high level DE&I behavior change book, right? So when we're talking about the domains of learning, the cognitive domain is about knowledge, it's about learning the skills, right? But when we move into the behavior change, we want to make sure that people are comfortable having those conversations, that they really understand the definitions of the words. And this company went straight for the most difficult conversation, which is race, right? And racism and privilege, right? The words privilege. And when people don't have the common language within their organization, there's always going to be this feeling of, why am I learning this? This is something that I don't believe in, maybe, you know? So I would say the very first thing you have to do as an organization is just understand where you're at. If you are just beginning your DE&I process, it's not going to help you to bring in these really difficult concepts for your organization to start to unpack when you don't already have that common language. So that's the first thing I can say. Start where you're at, right? You don't give kindergartners calculus, right? Unless, I don't know, they're geniuses, right? But the point is, you start them where they're at. They're probably just learning multiplication. No, they're learning 1 + 1, 1 - 1. They're not learning calculus, right? So don't start with calculus, because that's where you want them to be. So that's one thing I can say. And then the second thing is, again, here we go, executives saying, you know, can you just get this done as quickly as possible? You know, DE&I learning, or just any learning in general, should never be seen as checking the box, right? You don't want to just give it lip service. It needs to be seen as the kind of thing that is going to help your organization become successful. You want to instill these principles of diversity, equity, and inclusion. And if you even just took out the words diversity, equity, and inclusion and just replaced it with engagement, right? I think you would see that all organizations understand that their number one asset is their number one asset and resource is the people in the organization. So if you optimize the people in the organization so that they can work better together, right? And you know, they can be able to perform better at their jobs, you're going to do better. And so we're literally taking this concept of DE&I and sometimes putting some fear around it and some feelings of, oh, you know, you just got to check the box, and forgetting that it's part of the whole. It's a holistic approach to your business success. Not only is it about the people in your organization, but also there are DE&I implications in the operations of your business. So, so sometimes I think DE&I is seen as a check the box, as, you know, we're just going to do this because we have to for our brand, right? And you forget that it should be part of your holistic approach to success in your organization.
Yeah. I mean, what you were just describing was something that's been tickling along in my mind as we've been chatting, that ultimately this is about making a better organization, about making it perform better as a whole, yes, producing better results, whether that's, you know, increasing profits or reducing risk, you know, all of those things. And it's about removing some of the barriers that we might not always acknowledge have always been there, you know, about, you know, getting to the place where we want our organization to get. Yeah. And even just talking about, you know, kindergartners and calculus, I mean, in the learning and development world, we already know, you know, you start where people are at as individuals, what they need, and build up and scaffold and structure. So it's interesting to hear that phrase, though, at the organizational level, something that maybe we don't always think about. So we think about the fact that, yeah, we can obtain some DEI courses, we can throw some programs into the mix, but it's still, like everything else that we have to do in L&D, it requires some baseline analysis to at least to know where we're actually at, so that we're doing the right and the most sensible things for yes, that level. Yeah.
It's just like, you know, I'm pretty sure half of the people maybe who are on the show right now went through maybe a degree in ed tech, or you're in the educational technology, instructional technology field. So we all learned the ADDIE model, right? Mm-hmm. So you first analyze, right? You measure first. You just never just jump right in, because you know, you don't know what you don't know, right? And so it's important to just measure first and then cut, you know, measure twice and cut once, right? As, our carpenters teach us that. But the point, I guess, you know, you're also making here is that I think you have to see this process as a cycle, right? So you always want to have this cycle of inquiry where you measure, you implement, right? And then you have the cycle of inquiry that says, okay, what were the results? Do we need to measure again, right? Because now we're at a different position. But if I can just give you pretty quickly like an explanation of how to implement DE&I training, I think I like to see it as bookends, right? What do the bookends do on a bookcase?
Like, keep the other thing, keep things from falling down, basically.
Keep things from falling down, right? So what you want to do with your D&I training is you want to make sure you have bookends, right? So the books in the middle are your D&I training. And if you don't have bookends, they're just going to be like falling off, right? And your bookends have to do with your pre-assessment. So first you meet people where they're at, right? And then you have the other bookend at the end, that's the behavior change. So for example, one of the things that I've done is create a program, like let's say we have a 30-minute training that's an online training. So I work for a company called Open Sesame, and we are the, you know, world's largest marketplace for online training. And one of the great things that I have found, and you know, I've been working with Open Sesame for 8 years, and the beauty about having e-learning is that people learn at their own pace, right? So people can pick up the learning and learn it at their own pace. You implement it into the LMS. But the important thing here is once the learning has happened, you have to have bookends. So you do the pre-assessment, you find out where people at, you give them the 30-minute module. But then for the other side of the bookend, you create opportunities for people to practice what they've learned. Unless people practice what they learn in the learning, they're never going to use it. So if you want people to learn about identifying bias, right, and being able to check their biases and reduce their biases, or to be really good bystanders or upstanders, you know, whatever you're looking for, you have to create space in your organization for people to practice these things. And so the other side of the bookend is creating opportunities for people to get together and discuss what they learned. So you could take that 30-minute module and divide it up into 10-minute modules that are sprinkled in. Remember, we're watering the brains. So every week, everybody just now focuses on one part of the module every week. And so that's a simple formula of implementing a topic, I guess, implementing a topic within your organization in regards to DE&I.
Yeah. I mean, it's about individual behavior change, but all of that adding up to organizational behavioral change, the big picture.
Yes. Yes. Okay. So I'm glad you brought that up, because I think a lot of times we see this as everybody must do this unconscious bias training. Well, yeah, that's good for everyone to do it, but not everybody's on the same place in the organization in terms of impact. The type of bias training that HR recruiters need is different, right? Because they're there to reduce bias in hiring, right? So they need an extra level. Even hiring managers need an extra level of training, in addition to maybe frontline employees who may just need to be introduced to the concept of what is bias, you know? You know, unconscious bias versus implicit bias. Is that the same thing? You know, so we have all these different ways that you could be implementing bias training without saying everyone needs to take this one course. We've checked our box. We're done. We don't want engagement to turn into compliance, to be seen like it's compliance training, because that's not what it is. Right.
Yeah. I think sometimes when compliance training, there's that phrase that locks are only good for honest people. You know, compliance training only works because people are already, you know, honest or in that space that the training is going to try to address. And it's, and it is so much a check of the box. You've got to do the annual security, you know, agreement or you know, whatever, or the health and safety training, et cetera. And moving that then out of the realm of just that one shot annual thing. We had a project way back that we were doing, And it was a very simple amount of slides and a one question test, which was basically a multiple choice, which was more or less an agreement that you agreed to the security. And the day that it was due, the annual date that everybody had to do it, something like 18,000 people tried to take that course in order to put the check mark in their LMS box, because everybody waited till the last minute. And the LMS vendor had to thankfully, they'd been through this a couple of times and they knew it was coming. So they were, you know, able to facilitate that massive amount. But that for me, it's always been my strongest sort of example of that, really the silliness early of compliance training.
Yeah.
Last minute, everybody does it. Push forward.
Yeah.
Multiple choice, but there's really only one answer, and that is I agree, and therefore everybody passed, and okay, it's done, and now we can forget about it for 364 more days, 365
and everyone knows the hacks, right? You take screenshots and you send it to all your friends so that they don't have to do the quiz and figure the answers out, right? So it's like, not that I'm saying we did that, right? But I think the point here is when you have an organization and that's how you're implementing your training, you did something wrong, right? People should be in a situation where, even if it's compliance training, it should never feel like a check of the box. It should feel like we do this because this is what we do to become successful. We are a safe organization, right? So we want to create a culture of safety. And people who want to create a culture of safety, they're safety champions or whatever you want to call it, right? You create this sense of excitement around it, right? Where it should not feel like a milestone. It should really just feel like an accomplishment in terms of, you know, I did this for the team, right? I'm here because I want so-and-so to be safe and go home to their families, right? Which is really what compliance training is about, right? It's about not only psychological safety, but also physical safety. So yeah, I would say organizations that, you know, compliance is just checking the box, then are you really truly safe, right? You should, that should be a measure of not being successful in creating a safe culture.
Very much so. And as you say, bringing it back to the DE&I kind of realm as a, you know, a learning area, the fact is you've got to constantly, as you've mentioned with the IDI model, bring it back, remeasure, do something different. What's the next step? What's the next next place that we need to go as an organization? Really very cool. I think, though, we're kind of hitting up towards the end of our time here. Let me just do two things. First of all, since Brent's not,
I'd normally start playing the music. I know, right now, but
and I'm looking down at my iPad, trying to get the button and such. I can't do three things at once. I can't talk and apparently push my play button.
This was the absolute worst day for me to be in the top secret bunker and having bad internet. I really, really, really wanted to engage more. I'm really sorry.
No worries. This has been absolutely a fabulous session. Such an important topic,
yeah.
Both for learning and development world as well as, you know, organizations at large. Liza, just take a minute and toss in. I'm going to start the music and see if we can do that. Take a minute, toss in your contact info where people can find you and where you might want them to connect with you. And folks who are joining us, we will get a copy of the slides that Liza had, and we'll give you guys a link to that. Just check out the posting we have on our blog. What else do we want to do? We want to talk about the
idiotic LinkedIn group. I'm dropping a link right now.
Oh, you got that one? Brilliant. Brent's still here with the link. Awesome. Liza, thanks so much for joining us today. As I say, it's such a critical and important topic. It touches on so many other pieces of what we have to do in the L&D world. Thanks for bringing it to us here today. And we really look forward to having you come back, Liza, and join us and talk about this some more sometime.
I would love to. It's really, truly been a pleasure. And I feel like we're going to talk for long. Yeah. So I really feel like I got to get to know y'all. And thank you so much for inviting me to have some coffee with y'all. Thanks.
Our pleasure. Gang, hope the rest of your weeks are great for everybody who's joining us in the chat. Thanks so much, as always, for your comments and your feedback and those sorts of things. And we'll see you next time. In the meantime, let's dance on out.
Thanks, everybody.
I'm going to try to copy you. Have a routine going. Come on.
I've got one
hand. This is mirroring, right?
I've got to have one hand on the music.
Woo! Two fingers.
Thanks so much, everybody. We'll see you all next time.
Take care, everybody. Big finale.
Here it comes.
Perfect.